it is wonderful to have you in the house here at the main stage of the Javits Center. Boy, did we have a great hour in store for all of you. Especially if you are a fan of, oh, I don't know, the Greaserverse in the house in here. Yeah. Oh my goodness, well, we've got such a fantastic panel that you are going to love. And if you don't know what the Greaserverse is, let me tell you. Back in 2012, on just a wonderful series of books by author Leigh Bardugo, yes, Shadow and Bone, kicked off an amazing series and created a brand new universe that has now thousands and thousands of fans, so much so that Netflix ended up putting up a wonderful series just last year of Shadow and Bone. And we have some of the stars here today to talk with all of you. You look gorgeous, doesn't she? Yeah. Oh my gosh, Leigh, this has to be, I mean, you've been riding this wave of success with the Greaserverse. I mean, but does it ever get old to walk out on a stage like this with all of these fans who have just have embraced your work? What does that feel like?
incredibly weird and delightful, but also I can't see your faces because it's dark, which makes me sad. But also, like, I've never done an entrance like that where it's like, I felt like we were in, like, we're gonna wrestle. Like, it's like the WWE. Which we're made.
On to wrestle.
Welcome to the ring. Welcome. Well, it's just incredible to have all of you here. And boy, has Shadow and Bone really taken off here, right? Are you guys huge fans? And we're just thrilled to have all four of you here. So we're just gonna talk about the show. That sounds all right with you. You know, let's start off. Leigh, I know you probably are asked a lot. If you can sum up the Greaserverse and how it began for you, how did it begin for you? Where did this idea come from? How do you start a universe?
Wow.
I know it's a loaded question.
What is life?
What is life? What is the universe? Basically, I was at a friend's house, and I was reading a book. And I don't remember what it was, but it couldn't have been that good because I fell asleep while I was reading it. Sorry.
No, it was really good, I guess, huh?
And compelling. And when I woke up, the house was completely dark. Like, country dark, where you can't see your hand in front of your face. And I was sure there was a murderer in the house, because what murderers do is they wait for you to wake up before they kill you.
Of course.
So I took my shoe off and was like, let's do this! But no one came to attack me, or maybe they were just terrified of me, who knows. And as I was getting ready for bed, once I calmed down and like checked under the beds in the closets, I couldn't get the idea out of my head, what if darkness was a place? And what if the monsters you imagined there were real, and you had to fight them on their own territory? And honestly, that was the beginning. That question was where the rest of the Greaserverse came from.
Fantastic. You guys love it, right? A moment of honesty right now, Lee, as I'm talking to you and everyone here. Moment of honesty, and the cast over here can one-up me on this, but all the names, where do you come up with such incredible and creative names? And I wanted to make sure I was getting the pronunciations right for today. As an author, and you're creating a world, you're creating characters, how do you do that? I mean, that's fascinating to me.
I mean, I can tell you that Ben's name, but the Darkling's name, was a big issue of contention in the writer's room because I don't reveal his actual name until the third book, which you can get away with in a book, but much tougher to do in a television series. Yeah. So we had a lot of conversations about that, and Kerrigan is actually a character who comes up later in the books, but the writer's room liked it, and I loved the idea that he had sort of stolen the name of this nobleman to use as his own. He's like that, what can I tell you? But Jesper Fahey was named after my friend Morgan Fahey, who is Irish, and Kaz Brekker was actually going to be Baz Brekker.
No.
I know.
We've been calling him Baz on set forever.
Yeah. When he's naughty, we call him Baz Cracker.
Whenever I drop something and do something uncool.
There, you're like, you could never do anything uncool. No, he was supposed to be Baz Brekker, and then a series came out, Rainbow Rowell series, Carry On, and there's a main character named Baz, and I was like, there can't be two Bazes. And I feel like Baz Brekker feels much more like showman-like, So, and then Inej's name came to me sort of instantly. I just knew who she was, and then when I saw Amita, I was like, oh, yeah, she arrived.
That's a wonderful compliment, Amita. That's gonna be wonderful. Let me ask the actors here. So you're now part of Shadow and Bone, and everyone's loving it, and we have another season that's gonna be coming out, correct? Yes. Amita, I'm gonna start with you. How familiar were you with the Grishaverse and the book series before this role came your way?
So I got the audition through, and I realized it was Shadow and Bone, and then I was in the Six of Crows duology, and I picked up the book straight away, started reading it, and I just could not put it down until I finished the last final words of Six of Crows, and then to my wonderful surprise, there was another book called Crooked Kingdom, so I went out and got that. And instead of focusing on my audition, I was too busy reading the books because they were so good. And then I ended up doing my tape, which was my first round, and wasn't very good. I didn't think it was, because I wanted the part so badly that no matter how many, you know, takes I did, it just didn't feel like it was enough. And then luckily, I got a recall, and by that time, I'd finished all of it, so I could focus on my audition.
Yes.
And luckily, ended up getting the part, and here I am.
Yeah!
Can I just say,
please?
I know you're saying your tape was bad, but literally, when she came on the screen, I was like, oh no, she looks exactly like Edge, and I was like, please let her be good, because you don't know, right? Like, that person is beautiful. And then they start talking, and like, oh, please be quiet. But instead, I started crying like halfway through the tape. I was like, it's her. And then we were just like, please let her want to do the show. Like, it was really intense.
Lee, I love it. You're like their biggest champion. I just love how excited. You can hear it in her voice, right? Just how exciting this is. Freddie, similar with the same question here. Were you a big fan of the books ahead of time? Did you know about
I had heard of the Grishaverse before, yeah. But as I got the same sort of audition email through as Amita did, but it came with this very useful website called Grisha Wiki.
Yes.
And I lost 2 to 3 working days on that website. I went down the rabbit holes, and I went and bought the books, and I started reading Six of Crows, and I got to the first sentence, actually, of the second chapter, which says, Kaz Brekker didn't need a reason. And I thought,
powerful.
And I thought, I am going to stop there, because if I don't get this part, I'll be so, so upset, because everything was in that one sentence. And so I had to stop myself until I found out I got the part.
Yeah. Kit, I'm going to take it to you with this one. Do you feel pressure, you know, because Shadow and Bone and the whole Grishaverse series of the books that have come afterwards are a huge success, a huge following. Do you feel the pressure to portray your character, you know, up to everyone's expectations? Do you channel that or you try to push that out of your mind?
How many people are in this room waiting to see what I'm gonna say?
Yes.
Or waiting to see what I might do.
Yeah. Pressure's real, man.
Yeah.
It's real. It's legit. I definitely felt that way because we were kind of all cast together, but these two were cast before, and so I also had to fit into a trio. Even if I could play Jesper, I have to be the right Jesper for this cast and this and Edge. And so I definitely felt that pressure, and then when we were announced, we hadn't started shooting yet, but all of you had ideas.
Oh, and they do.
Yeah.
In a good way.
In a great way, but the expectation that you might have and the you know, the kind of, the wait to find out what it's gonna be, like we have that too. Like, cause we're excited to see what it's gonna be. We don't really know. We, you know, I always say, you know, we were making something that we thought was cool.
Yeah.
We're really glad you agree, but that's never for certain. And so now I think I'm in a place where I can let myself just live it a bit. But at the beginning it was bloody terrifying.
Sure.
Just falling asleep counting goats.
Goats.
Oh, still counting goats. He's a bigger star than me these days. It's quite... Who thought I would become the sidekick? Not me.
Now, Ben Barnes, the audience loves you. And you know,
I know.
Thank Ben, you. This isn't your first rodeo, you know, approaching a character that is famous from another literary series, Prince Caspian from the Pound of So, taking on another huge role in another huge book series. Is this something that you're attracted to? Is this just something that excites you? Or, yeah, how do you feel about it? Take it in.
Yes, it is something that excites me because you have these Bibles that you can go back to. And I think that the tools that we have to play with in sort of creating these characters, the descriptions of them, but the words that they speak, and I love words, I'm sure a lot of you do too. That makes me a logophile. Lover of words, which I learned quite recently, probably from Freddie.
I love the way you say that, I mean, it sounds filthy. Like, let me drop some Latin on you.
Logophile. I wasn't a stranger to the sort of the pressure of, particularly with the Narnia stories. I love those books from when I was 8 years old. I still have my copy, and so to be casting something like that, I think I put quite a lot of pressure on myself, you know. And I hadn't really done one, maybe two films by that point. Was quite green, didn't know what I was doing really. So. But by the time it came around to this, I've been doing this a little while, and I felt like this character had a sort of pieces from some of the other characters that I played, or things that I felt confident I knew how to portray. But then I actually called Lee on the day that we were filming the scene in the tent where I test Alina. Sort of the first proper scene that you see Kerrigan in. And I said, I have been in these worlds. I've played living, real people who were with me on set, and I've done these very famous books. I've done, you know, adaptations from Dorian Gray to Narnia. But I've never felt like I was in a story for a whole day. And when I was filming that in the tent looked like I imagined it. Alina looked like I imagined her. The costume felt how I imagined it would feel. And I called you and I said, I feel like I'm in a story. I feel like I'm on a page. All day I felt that way. And that's when I thought we were sort of onto something a bit special with it. Yeah. I don't know what you asked me, but
no, absolutely. You answered it, but then you added to it. You answered it. It was great. Lee, to see your book series, this is the early part of the series, come now to a successful series. For you, as you were writing and imagining it, you now to see it, is it similar? You know, to tag on like what Ben was just saying, I felt like I was really there. This is the tent. This was what I thought it should feel like. Do you have similar feelings? Or?
I mean, look, when you're writing a book, your only goal is, are there writers? Writers in the room?
Writers?
Some of our people. When you're writing a book, your only goal is to finish the book, right? So sometimes you can't help it. Your mind will wander and you will begin to dream of, your ambition gets the best of you and you dream of someday having an adaptation. But all there really is you in the work for a very long time. And then it goes out in the world and it finds readers and you hope that they see the things that you've imagined. And sometimes you're lucky enough to get fan art or cosplay and you get to see people bring the words to life in that way. And then, to actually have this happen, like, there was a part of me that did not actually believe this was happening. Like, I was like, when they sent me the first dailies, I was like, oh.
You were still saying that as it was about to air.
Yes.
It was already in the can.
I do what is called disaster origami. Like, you can give me anything, and I will be like, look, I made it bad.
Oh.
Yeah. It's scary. That's how my life is, waiting for things to go wrong. So I was like, they're not gonna air it. I don't know. They say it's gonna air, but who can say? So
it sounds like the basis of another book, I mean, honestly.
But for me, being on set, getting to meet them for the first time, they can all tell you how I cried. I cry at everything. I absolutely wept. And then also getting to actually be in the show just briefly. And to do that particular scene was, I was just supposed to be in a scene where, like, opened the door for Alina. And instead I got to be in this huge scene that I remember writing. I remember sitting at my dining room table and writing this moment and trying to figure out the choreography of it and trying to figure out the Darklyn's lines in this moment, and to suddenly be there, like, was it was the most beautiful thing. Like, it was just the most beautiful experience, and so few people get to do it. And the reason I got to do it was honestly because of all of you guys. So thank you for that, and thank you to all of you.
I think that's just such a beautiful thing to hear. Isn't that wonderful, everybody? Isn't that wonderful? So. With the great talent we have here on stage, how helpful was Lee while filming Shadow and Bone? Any of you want to take that? Was she a great asset to, you know, develop?
This is such a loaded question. What if they were like, oh, she was a disaster?
Well, I was, yeah.
No, well, I'm gonna get straight in and say 100%, because especially for us three, yeah, we were the only people on season one that weren't adapting any specific scenes.
Sure.
And so, The books were, you know, it's resource number one. And the way that we were trying to build characters, you go like, well, if I do a little bit of this bit here and I do a bit of that, like, I remember the first time I was walking through Getterdam and I was like, oh, there's a little quote about how Jesper's always in motion. And I was like, oh, that's when I'll use this bit. And you gradually get to build it, but really, I think, you know, because I was with Kazan and Edge, I was like, oh, my job's really easy now. Because we all kind of built that together, but having Lee as a present person in our process completely changes the game, because you stop pretending and you can actually really engage with the thing, and it gets deeper and hopefully it ends up being quite good.
And also, I would say, even if you've been doing it 20 years, apart from the words, the other tool that you have as an actor, are there any actors, writers, actors, that, you know, one of the most precious tools that you can have, and it's a tricky little bedfellow, but it is confidence. And it wanes, even if you've been doing it 20 years, even if you've been cast as other things, even if everyone wants you to play that part, you still can step on and that confidence can waver. So to have someone like Lee, who's created the world, saying, this is how I imagined it, thanks for being here, or just to have you to, like, ask a question, just be like, how do you see this moment going, or I'm trying to get this line into this scene, do you think it could fit here? To have that, to make you, to amp your confidence in that way, so you can walk on and have your shoulders broad and your chest up and be like, I'm free to make my own decisions in this moment and kind of own this character, because some of these characters need ownership. So to have that confidence, that fuel from someone who literally created it from their head whilst sleeping, is an extraordinary asset.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. You know, the themes of the stories, and Leah, I'll start with you on this, you know. So it's a young adult, you know. In addition, you know, to the magic that's part of it as well, but, you know, you're also dealing with themes of, you know, struggling to fit in, young love, politics, you know. Was that something that was definitely you wanted to focus on, especially gearing to young readers out there, you know, youth out there that are going to be reading this, as, you know, to be effective with them?
I mean, I don't really think about books that way. I don't think about, look, every reader is different, right? So I have met 15-year-olds who are more mature than 35-year-olds, you know, so, and I have met people who live in fiction in a way that allows them, like, I always feel like fantasy fans have an edge on everybody else because we see possibility where nobody else sees it. For us, you know, the call box is always bigger on the inside. Like, we are always looking for that gap in the woods where, that's how we live, and I would hate to lose that. And for me, writing fantasy, it is about politics, but it can also simply be about getting to live in a world where being brave and strong and clever and capable is more important than, say, being cute and popular.
Hey, yes.
I wasn't. So, you know, to me, those are the places we get to live, and the big themes that come through just come from trying to write honestly, you know. And for me too, with these actors, you know, it's funny, I think adaptation is a game of trust, right? Like, you have to trust the partners you're working with. And when we got this cast together, I suddenly felt like, you always say it's like lightning striking. Well, this was lightning striking again and again and again. And suddenly we had these incredible people who are not only phenomenal actors, but genuinely kind people. And that lets you, as an author, step back and say, I trust them. I trust them to do what they need to do with these characters. They're going to go places that I didn't anticipate. And that's really just incredible to watch. So.
Yeah. Again, aren't you just loving her enthusiasm about it? It's so gentle.
I feel like we're in a cult. Like,
I don't want you to feel that way, but it's so nice to hear, you know, just, you know, just a wonderful time in your life, and, you know, a wonderful time in all of these fine actors up here, and for a reception as grand as this is, it's incredible. I mean, you know, I'm sure you've been hearing so much from the first season, great responses from it. What have you been hearing from fans? Why do you think they are responding so well to the film adaptation or the series adaptation of it?
I think it's because Lee Bardugo, you brought us all together. And I think the first place any of us who wasn't part of this world started from was a love for the storytelling, a love for the words, a love for the journey that we went through when reading those books. And I think when you get given such fantastic material where you just can't help but root for these characters and root for the author. And I think because it started from such a place of love, and you know, I came onto the show wanting to give every single part of myself to, because the fandom is worldwide, and you know, it means so much to people, and it meant so much to me, and my character meant everything to me. She was an inspiration to me, still is. So that was our common ground, and then we met these wonderful people here. So what was not to love? And I think the fandom, you guys feel it as well. I feel it with you every time I see you, and I have the pleasure of hugging you and meeting you. I feel all of this love, and it started from the Grishaverse, and it will live on forever. I forgot the question, but...
You've answered it. Yeah, it's beautiful. Mic drop. Is similar? Are you hearing wonderful things, you know, from fans out there that you've been able to meet? You know, what are some things that are standing out to you that you never thought while making it, how it's really affecting folks out there? Anything in particular you're hearing?
I don't know if I didn't expect this, but for me, reading the books the first time and reading the scripts and making the show, it was very much about found family and finding your place in the world. I mean, like you said, it's not about being cute or popular, it's about finding your place. Because you're smart, or because you're good at shooting people, or, you know. Everyone's got their place.
You get it, kid. You get it.
And I think because we had such an amazing time making it, and we did find a family as we were making it with the creatives and with the cast, I feel like that's really translated onto screen, and that is what I get.
Would you agree, everyone out here? Would you agree with that? I've been able to talk to you just for 30 minutes now or so, and you can feel it. You can feel it with all of you, and I feel, even though, you know, the Grishaverse, the novels have been around for a while, but we're now on the beginning, I think, of where it's going to be adapted into more television series, maybe a film down the line. Who knows, you know, who knows where we're gonna go with it. But don't you feel we're like at the beginning of something just huge here? Yeah? Yeah, it's just terrific. All right, some fun stuff, because everyone likes the behind the scenes stuff of filming. And this is for anyone here. Any fun bloopers or behind the scenes that stand out in filming season one? Amita's like, oh yeah, what do you got?
We're so professional. There's no bloopers.
Anything that was fun from filming that folks would like to hear about?
I realized playing such a cool character how uncool I am in real life. So I, you know, I try to be cool on multiple.
Ben's like cracking up over here.
See? Time.
Oh,
yeah.
All right. Come on, here we go.
So here we are, episode 8.
Episode 8. Has everyone seen the show? So you may remember there's a moment where Inej throws a certain weapon, of which he has many, into the Darkling's
hot pull out of myself, do some brilliant acting. It's so good, questionable. And then some questionable acting. But every single time, for some unknown reason, nobody asked us to do this, every single time that Amita threw this particular weapon,
this would come out of her mouth.
And action.
It went on for days.
In the whole world. Every single time she did it.
No!
So sometimes when we greet each other, we just go, no!
That's awesome. Kira, she's thinking over there. I think that's fun that stood out for you from filming.
I mean, all of it, really. I mean, I know that's a boring answer. But also, what I will say is, there's a lot of love on this stage, right? We've all been saying really lovely things to each other, but that's just for you. We're really horrible to each other.
I mean, we assume so.
Like, there's... I'm done with these people. I can't say anything other than, in Netflix we trust. We came in and we just got to pick up where we left off. And we had all of these memories together, and we had a huge level of excitement, because now people know what it is, and we know what it is better. We're not just guessing. We can watch season one and go, oh, okay, that's what we're aiming for. But it also meant that we mucked around a lot more. I ended up kind of shouting acting before every scene, or at least I did, I don't know.
Seems to be a lot of shouting, just
a lot of shouting. Things,
yeah.
It's nice. I'm not saying anything else. You have to wait for the blooper reel.
I will say that when I visited set, and this was after they had been on set in a foreign country for 6 months, you'd be sitting and you would hear them in the green room, which was a tent, you know, and they would be singing together. Like they were at summer camp, and they would all, and they're very good singers too, but they would all just be singing, and I was like, what is happening here? Like, it was pretty magical.
One big kumbaya, yeah?
If I remember correctly, it was Zero to Hero from Hercules.
Excellent choice.
Yeah, Kit, I'm on now.
What have you done?
I'm so sorry.
Oh, wow.
Come on, Kit.
Oh, I hear you.
Help was born. Actually, not the right song.
That's great. There you go.
looking forward to season two, but recently, Lee, just this past week, I believe your newest novel for the Grishaverse has come out. Is that right? Yeah. Demon Inglewood, everyone, are we seeing this right here? Yeah. Get this on camera here. Demon in the Wood has just come out, and it's expanding the Darkling's origin story, which says here back.
Baby Dark over in the house.
Baby Darkles.
Yeah, what can you tell us about the new addition to the Grishaverse?
Yeah, it is the first Grishaverse graphic novel, and we also have an amazing audiobook that Ben was kind enough to
lend his voice to. So dulcet tones of Ben Barnes lulling you to sleep gently, gently.
Logophone.
It's mostly just him reciting words in Latin. It's fantastic. But yeah, it was. This was something I wanted to do for a long time. It allowed us to expand this short story, and for me, you know, the Darkling, General Kerrigan, has always been a compelling character because my goal in writing him was that you should always be questioning whether you agree with him. That there should be a moment where you're like, well, he has a point. So for me, that story is about elucidating that point and not just showing him at an earlier time, but showing his mother at an earlier time and Ravka at an earlier time, Fjord at an earlier time, so that we see the forces that shaped this person who is actually, you know, literally going to be the person who guides his country, for better or worse, moving forward.
Great, that's great. Are you all gonna be going out to get the book, right? Fantastic.
That is a binding contract.
It is. Yeah. By you getting a ticket, that's exactly what it is. That's what you're gonna be doing. And you know, if you don't, then this one up here is just gonna start you throwing things at you.
Knife!
Yeah! That's right.
I came to this through the show because my girlfriend talked me into watching it, and I didn't know how I'd feel about it, and now I'm obsessed with it. I just want to know your opinions about, like, fans like me who are finding this universe, like, through the show first and now going and reading on the book. Sorry.
I mean, it's an absolute blessing. Like, wherever your girlfriend is, love you. Thank you. Look, the dream of the show for me was not just to see these beautiful people embody these characters. It also means your story reaches new people. And that's all as writers we can hope for. So you are very welcome to be here. Now buy my book.
I bought all of them now. I bought them. Yes.
You may stay.
Let's take it on over here. How about your name and what's your question?
Hi, I'm Gabi. I'm from Brazil.
Welcome.
Thank you. So in season one, we had the Darkling and the Crows meeting, which we don't have in the books. So for Lee, I would like to know how it felt for you to see these characters together. And for the cast, can we have this encounter again in season two, maybe?
In Netflix, we trust.
Oh, you meaning you want, okay, so I will say, I can't say anything about season two. Netflix will descend from the sky and shoot me with a blow dart, but so for me, this was one of the most exciting things about the show, and something that Eric Heiserer and I talked about early on. It allowed us to expand the universe in a way that the universe had to grow sort of organically through the books, but we were allowed to present every side of it. The royalty, the chosen ones, the people who are not chosen ones. So that for me was thrilling. And also, it allowed us to have this moment, which was sort of our like Superman versus Batman, which is like, you know, Kaz versus Darkling, which is a question I always got, and I was like, well, now we will see. So I thought it was just a brilliant idea, and everybody was so skeptical.
You're both Batman, okay? He ran away. You got beaten by a smoke bomb.
Remember that family feeling we had a few moments ago?
This is where it all comes out.
Great, thank you so much for your question. Let's take it on over here. Hi! Oh, there's a sign here that you're holding that says, you see that, Ben?
Yeah, he does. For anyone who hasn't seen, this sign says, the Darkling sucks.
With a Z. Yeah, what's your name, what's your question?
Hi, my name is Sam, and I'm a writer, and I love, like, thinking about what my characters would do in, like, weird situations. So this is for all the actors, because I asked you this yesterday. What would your characters go to karaoke song be? slices.
Karaoke song?
Yes.
Zero to hero.
If anyone has one.
Oh.
Well, Lee, you're already choosing it for the character. Get
Lee's picked them all for
us. She's picked them. What are you picking, Lee?
This is great.
So this is canon now, because
it's
it's official. Right, so Anita's karaoke song, so Inez's karaoke song is...
She asked me last night, and she said, Darkling and Kaz, what were their karaoke song? And I was like, you have picked the two people least likely to do karaoke. You, I gave I Will Survive.
Yeah?
Because at first you were afraid, you were petrified, but... And for Kaz... I chose Dancing Queen by ABBA. Yeah.
That's me in my trailer every morning.
Everyone,
myself up, Dancing Queen. Yeah, that's good.
I did ask this at one point. You're right. You just, Freddie just reminded me. I had Total Eclipse of the Heart. You right?
Yeah. Cool. Thank you so much. Yeah. Let's take it on over here. Hi, what's your name?
Is that Dominic? Jasper will probably do all of Bohemian Rhapsody.
You get to minute three, you'll be like, all right, man.
My name is Marissa, and I'm from Philadelphia. and I'm a circus artist, so Inez is my hero. But my question is, what is one thing you learned during filming season one that you kind of took with you into season two? Not, it doesn't have to do with any plot, but just like in yourself.
Weapons.
Amina, because she just loves Inez, do you have anything to add into that?
That's a fantastic question. I took with me the lesson of always carrying heat pads because it was so cold. I think it was just taking the whole experience and remembering, because It's a different experience when you filmed it and then the show comes out and then you have a big break and then season two you're filming, but all you have left is kind of the show that's in front of you, and then because that's the only thing you end up seeing, you end up forgetting so much of the process of making it. So the lesson from that was just taking lots of.
Finish this
thought. Taking lots of pictures.
Thank you for your question. Thank you so much. Let's take it on over here. Let's take it over here. Hi, what's your name?
Hi, my name's Faith. Not asking plot-wise, but for the Crows, I know, Kit, you talked a little bit about having to fit in your Jesper to, Amina and Freddie's dynamic. And I know we've seen in the teaser for season two, so it's not like a spoiler, but we've seen that you guys end up with Violin and Nina at one point. How was it adapting the group dynamic that you three had and bringing new people into it?
It was terrible.
They are a nightmare.
Yeah, I mean, we don't even talk to them anymore, do we?
No.
Lemmings?
No, but it's one of their names. But it was really interesting, because actually, from a filmmaking point of view, the structure of our scenes is very different. Because on the whole, the three of us went on a tour of very dank, dark rooms in the Grecianverse, plotting. And so the three of us shoot a certain way, you know, go, we do that, then we do that, then we do that, then it's done. And suddenly you have scenes with 5, 6, 7, 8 people. And the nature of the beast is completely different in terms of passing the baton. You're like, okay, it goes from Kaz, then it goes to this person, then to that person. And you're kind of really sharing, the dialogue. Yeah, which is unfortunate, because I don't get all the jokes anymore. I know,
I'm sorry in advance. But no, but it's you really have to welcome people in, and for people like Jack, Paddy, Lewis, Anna, yeah, big up. But like, you know, they're brand new, so they're coming and going, what is this? And it's like, no, welcome, the more the merrier. It's the same for those of you who found the books after the show. The more the merrier. That's the thing here. So, yeah, I think that's it.
Terrific. Thank you so much. Hi, what's your name? What's your question?
Hi, I'm Maddie. I'm from California. My question is, Lee, I notice you tend to write tragedies a lot.
I'm pretty sure they're all rom-coms. Tom Hanks and Meg Ryan are going to be in one of these, I'm sure, right?
No. I was wondering what within tragedy inspires you so much, and for all the actors, how do you prepare for a role that is such, you know, has such a tragic backstory?
Oh, buddy. look, I don't think I write tragedies. I actually think my stories are very hopeful and full of jokes. But mostly, I try to tell stories honestly. So I'm not interested in telling a story where there are no casualties, but there's a war. That doesn't happen. I'm not interested in telling stories where there's no price to be paid, and where your past doesn't come back to bother you, and where trauma is solved with a kiss. That's not how life works. So I'm not interested in writing that. That said, when I was on set for season two, and I cannot give this away, but there was a scene they were shooting, and there was a small child crying in the scene, and he was a very good actor. And I was like, oh God, I am a monster. I have done a horrible thing. And then I sort of patted myself on the back.
There you go. There you go. Thank you. Hi. What's your name? What's your question?
Hi, I'm Simone. First, I just want to say I love you guys so much. Like, you're my favorite people in the world.
Thank you.
Okay, so my question, I guess it's mainly for Ben and Freddie, but Ben, you once referenced a video of Freddie eating a banana with his Taz gloves on, and you never posted the video, and I'm here to beg you for the video.
I would like to set the record very straight on one thing. It is not a video, it is a photograph. And I've made it very clear to Mr. Carter, as he insists on me calling him now.
And I suppose his lawyers have asked you to do that.
That it is entirely up to Freddie as to whether this photo will be posted or not, because I am not in the photograph. So...
Freddie, response? Next question.
Look, it's a very, it was a very intimate and special moment for the two of us.
I'd like to make it very clear, in this moment, I was not wearing any gloves.
We need to move on. Thank you. Thank you. This is like my
shadow man standing in front of a girl asking me to love her. You said you were in a rom-com.
Woo! Next question.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Hi, what's your name?
I'm Casey. I'm from New York. Ben, just want to say hi to you particularly.
Hello. Nice to see you again.
My question is for you, actually. So I'm a fan of the books before the show. And when I heard that it was being adapted to a Netflix series, but the Crows were in it, I was like, whoa, wait, what? So Shadow and Bone and then Six of Crows being combined together. How did you feel about that?
I felt good. Look, I think I got better as a writer as I went, right? And there seems to be some kind of like stigma against saying that. Like, I think that Six of Crows is a very, I could not have written Six of Crows before I wrote Shadow and Bone. So for me, every book has been a challenge. Every book has been an opportunity to do better and to show this world, this Grishaverse, in all of its variety. And I would be sorry to only see part of that made. So this was a chance. You know, our choices were, well, you can make Shadow and Bone and hope that you get the runway to make Six of Crows, or you can crash these two vehicles into each other.
Heck yeah.
And see what chaos ensues.
No, it was awesome. I was just wondering.
I mean, I agree. No, I loved it. I'm thrilled by it. And I can't bear the idea. And now I'm like, I can't imagine it. I can't imagine it a different way. I did. But I actually love this version of the universe. It feels like an alternate timeline.
That's great. That's great. Thank you so much. Hi, what's your name?
Hello, beautiful people. My name is Dahlia. First, I just want to say thank you so much for all the hard work you put into the TV show. We thank you for creating the Grishaverse. I can speak for everyone here that we really appreciate all that you do, so thank you.
If you don't mind me asking, what does it mean to you? What does it mean to you as a fan?
It just means, as we said, to question everything. Just don't follow the system. Believe what's in your gut. And yeah, also family as well. I can see from the crew that everyone's basically super close. Ups and downs here and there, as said Kit, but yeah. So my question is, if you could play any other character, what would it be?
Any other character in the series?
I think I would play...
You would or want to, yeah, either way, yeah.
I would love to have a go at probably Pagra. I know. It's the one person you always wanted to play too, but she's just so much older, and she's the Darkling's mum, and you know, I love children.
What?
So, yeah, why not?
Amita stole my answer. I always go for Bagra. She's the best.
Kit, how about you?
When reading, I read the Crow's books first, because I was on a tight deadline to start the jump. But then when I read the trilogy, I was like, even for, because I got to Crow Kingdom, I was like, who's this Sturmhand guy? But Paddy's fantastic. So you're all in for a treat. But yeah, that would be my instinct. Or, you know, there are new characters because of the show. Milo's kind of cool.
Yeah. Ben, and any other roles in the Grishaverse?
No.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much. So we have about 3 minutes left. Let's do rapid fire now. Okay, so we're just gonna go question and answer. We can try to get as many as we can. Go ahead.
Blue.
Yes, please.
I'm from Chicago. And all of your characters are very different and have very distinct personalities. And I want to know what you can relate to in your character from reading the books and what you took from them as, like, portraying them on screen.
Yeah, anyone want to take that?
A little quick fire version of that for me is that Jesper is this kind of... he deflects with charisma and charm and he's trying to be kind of above things and letting things not faze him, but actually there's a really vulnerable core there. And I was like, that's me on this job, pretending I know what I'm doing. So that just works every day, honestly, because it's so accessible as an actor. So that would be mine.
Yeah, thank you so much. We're just going to keep the rapid fire going right over here.
Hi there, my name's Katie. Thank you guys all for coming. So if you could take anything from set, which you obviously wouldn't because Netflix, you know, but that wasn't your own. It wasn't your own. What would you take from another cast member?
Like a prop?
Yeah, if you could have anything from set, it couldn't be your own. Whose item would you take?
I mean, I can tell you I have Kaz's cane now.
I'll tell you what I definitely wouldn't do. I wouldn't take a black kefta and put it on a mannequin in our showrunner's office without his knowledge. I definitely would not do that.
Not at all. Thank you so much. Right over here, we got about 60 seconds left.
Hi, I'm Casey, I'm from Massachusetts. Thank you all for being here, you all are amazing. My question was, is there any music that you guys listen to kind of like get into character, or Lee, was there any music that you listened to while you were writing the books?
I listen to a lot of Muse for the Dark Avenger.
I listen to a lot of the Black Keys.
I'm currently listening to Stavros the Finishing, which is amazing.
I listen to the Shadow and Bone soundtrack.
Great answer.